Hello, and welcome to Dickinson's Real Deal. Now, on this show, we help members of the public get the very best price for their antiques and valuables. We're going to sit you down with one of our regular dealers. They're going to try and tempt you with a cash offer on the table today.
£400.
I'd like some more, please.
You'd like some more, please. Yes. That Oliver, isn't it?
Yes. I'd like some more, please.
If I don't think that's enough money, I'm going to say, no way. Don't accept that. Have a gamble. Go to auction and see if you can get a little bit more money there. Today, the show comes to you from Preston. There's a great crowd of people here. You know why they're here? They want to do business. They want to walk away with the real deal.
We're straight over to Cheryl Hateney for her first deal of the day.
This pearl and gold bracelet, it could be 22 karat gold, but it might not be gold at all.
I would like round about the 500 mark for it, but I know I've got Cheryl, and I know she's a bit of a hard... she drives a hard bargain.
People do like hallmarks. They like to know what they're getting. So do I.
Will the lack of hallmarks prevent Cheryl from offering big? Let's find out.
Tell me about your very pretty piece of jewellery you brought.
Well, this belonged to my grandmother. She came from the Middle East, and when she passed away, she handed it down to my mother, who then passed it on to me. I think in 10 years, I've only probably worn it once to
an
evening do. And so I think it's better off really going in to someone who can really show it off and appreciate it, you know, for what it is.
How old do you think this piece is, if you can trace it back through the family?
Possibly 100. The thing is, there is no stamp on it, because the Middle Eastern jewellery...
Exactly, that's what I was going to say. Sometimes when we buy Middle Eastern gold, it is difficult to determine what carat it is. Yeah. It is usually 22 carats.
Yes,
I have had
it valued and tested, and it was confirmed that it is 22 with pearls.
My personal customers do like something that's marked, that they can identify. Sure. Mm-hmm. So that is a slight drawback with it. Mm-hmm. Not a huge drawback, just a slight drawback. Okay. But let's see how we go, Susan.
Fair enough.
We won't mess around.
Okay.
Okay. 50, 100, 150, 200, 250, 300, 350, 400. You're not looking excited.
Sorry. Should I?
450. £500. David.
Oh,
hello.
Have you tried it on?
No.
It would look fabulous on you.
It would. Oh. She's got a lovely slender wrist.
Oh, no.
Slender wrist. Did you see her eyes sparkle when she looked down at that? A beautiful item. I've looked at that, and I think you're right, Cheryl. Certainly made somewhere in the Middle East. My guess is the island of Bahrain, because famous for their pearls. I can tell you, we've weighed it, and allowing for the pearls, coming at £900 of gold, without the pearls, without the natural pearls. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So, I'm going to say 500, nowhere near. I think it's the type of piece one of our dealers could swan round in. And that just might be the dealer.
Pearls for though, they say. So I hope it's not going to be
love
my
pearls.
Tears.
No, I'm sure not.
Susan, right. £500. I haven't finished. 550, 600, 650, £700.
No, I'm sorry. Make it 800 and we have a deal.
I can't make it 800.
No.
I'm going to put another 50 down, Susan. £750, that's my final offer.
We have a deal.
We have a deal.
We have a deal.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Amazing, amazing. I wasn't expecting it to go for that much at all.
I think when she initially came in, she hoped only to get about £500. So she did really well getting £750.
Thank you. It was the real deal.
You can say that again, Susan. Congratulations. We're with John Parker, and he has a collection of beautifully ornate ivory geisha girls on his table.
I haven't a clue what they're worth. Hoping to get maybe 150.
One's damaged, I notice, which makes a huge difference, because to be worth anything, they have to be perfect.
I am going to try and do some good haggling. Get as much as possible.
Watch out, John. Eileen's ready to lock horns with you. David and auctioneer John Gerard are standing nearby to see who'll come out on top.
What have we got here? We've got some Japanese ivories, which I'm sure you know. How did you acquire them?
We inherited them.
Right.
From an aunt.
Mm-hmm. Yes, they're relatively common. They were sort of souvenirs. They were brought back by sailors travelling the world. Very nice quality. Ladies under sunshades. And these are little hardwood bases. The wood is called Hua Huang Li, and it was a
right.
very, very hard wood. They're probably about 1930s, something like that. Why are you selling them?
We've had them a long time, since the 1960s.
Mm. I've right.
got two daughters that probably would like them. I don't really want to split them up.
Yes, yes, because they're nice as a set, aren't they?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. I've noticed that there's a this one here has had her head off.
Right.
Damage, as I'm sure you know, is quite important. It makes a big, quite a difference to
yes.
the value.
Now, John, four small ivory figures, Oriental but Japanese, geisha girls, carving, I would have said, fairly average, probably tourist items.
I thought so, yes.
How desirable in the sale room?
They are selling. People are looking for them. They won't fetch a great amount. I could see him fetching a couple of £100s and should do that.
Okay. So you're where? 180, 220?
Yeah, somewhere around there.
Independent values are a bit lower, maybe 120, 180. The Duke's saying to you, I think, like John, somewhere around that 150 towards £200, that should be their money's worth. I'm not so sure that these are the kind of thing that our deal John buys, but let's see what he puts on the table.
Well, shall we start with some? So that's 50, and that's £60. How about? No?
No.
Not even tempted?
No.
Oh. Oh dear. Right.
No.
Well, if I change the 10 for a 20.
No, I was hoping for more than that.
You're hoping for more than
yeah.
that?
Hmm.
Well, if I put the 10 back again, so if I said we've got £80,
mm.
is that... I think you're a little bit tempted now, aren't you?
Not very.
Not very?
No. No, I think I could do with more than that.
Well, my final offer, as they say, my final offer would be another £10. That's, as they say, that's me done.
Right, now... I've just heard John say that's me done at £90. Let me tell you what the independent valuers and the auctioneer say. They vary. 120, 180. 180, 220. I think that's a bit on the low side, John. It probably isn't John's cup of tea. I'm going to say you want somewhere on that 150-ish up to 200, perhaps. Otherwise, it's worth a gamble at auction.
Thank you, David.
Well, there we are.
Over to you.
Over to me. Well, I'm going to stay at 90. So what do you think you're going to do?
I think I'll go to auction.
Well, I wish you all the very best and I hope it does very well for you.
Thank you very much.
Not at all. I think the damage gradually got to me. Unless it comes at a slightly lesser price, then really one shouldn't be buying it. It's, you know, after all, we're businessmen.
He thought it was a good offer. I didn't.
I think we should get close to the £200 mark in auction, so I'm quite confident in that.
Let's see if auctioneer John Gerard can get you the price you deserve then, Eileen.
If you're fortunate today and you sell them, what have you got in mind to do with the money?
My daughter's coming over with the family from Australia later on in the year, so it'll go to a good night out.
OK, good night out. What's your daughter called?
Sharon.
Sharon? G'day, Sharon. If you're down under in Australia, you're coming over to see Mum. Leave the Barbie there, get over here, have a bit of coal for a change, and then if we sell these items, we'll have a bit of a party. OK, they're coming up now, 180 to 220. I think they should go within that range. Let's see what they bring under the gavel.
Lot 50, pair of Japanese geisha women, realistically carved in ivory, together with two others. Bids with me at £140, at 140.
140? We need more than that. The reserve is 180.
150, 160, 160, 170.
We're at 160, we're creeping up. We're at 180.
£200.
We're at £200 now. £200.
And advance on 220. Centre the room, then at 220, we all finished.
Gavel's gone down. We have £220. Take away the commission, you're left with £180. Is that what's going to be spent on the party?
Hopefully.
All that grog?
Yes.
Get prawns on the Barbie. Over here, not over there. Should be a really good party. So on the day, £220, gavel price, taking home £180. Eileen is getting excited already. The party spirit, her daughter's coming over from Oz. It's going to be a real deal. A cracking party.
Eileen, I think the Duke was after an invite there.
£28, and he's on to £28.
Hello, Linda.
We're back in the den with James Late.
The sad truth about silver christening sets is that there are millions of them around and nobody wants them.
Thought about 60 to 80. But we'll have to see how it goes.
Well, I'll try and buy it, but, you know, they're not going to be worth very much money.
£60 is Linda's minimum, James. Do your best.
They brought along your christening set?
Yes.
Well, not yours, I guess.
No.
And ancestors? Has it been in the family for years?
Well, I think it must be my great-grandmother.
Yeah.
And it's just been passed down.
Yeah. I mean, it's a strange thing to give a newly christened child, a very sharp fork and a knife. Wouldn't happen now, would it?
No.
Health and safety.
Yes.
Anyway, it's Victorian. I did have a look at the mark earlier. I think it's 1875-ish, I think, and it's made in Sheffield, and it's got the Victoria head on it. Have you ever looked at the hallmarks?
No, I haven't, actually, no.
You should always look at hallmarks.
Yes.
On your family heirlooms. And it's a pretty spoon, isn't it? I mean, it's lovely.
Yes, it is.
It's got cutting at the back. Very decorative thing.
Mm.
The problem with christening sets is that nobody wants them anymore, which is very sad. I think every family in the land has probably got, like you, boxes of fish knives, christening sets, all sorts of things tucked away, which no one ever uses anymore.
No.
I think it's a terrible shame. I'd love to be able to use these things. Okay, I'll see if I can buy it from you.
Okay.
It's not going to be worth a huge amount of money, because it's not in vogue. Anyway, 40, £50.
I thought it would possibly be a little more than that.
It's only going to be a tiny bit more than that, because I've got to try and make a minuscule profit. So if I take the 10 away and put a 20 down, £60, I think that's really as far as I want to go with it.
Could you not That's
it, really, honestly. That's the reality of it at the moment, is that that really is all it's worth.
Right. Well, I was hoping for a little bit more, but I think, yes, I'll accept that.
OK, all right. Well, thanks very much for bringing it, and I'll try and find it a good home.
Yes, I'm quite happy, really. I didn't want it to go to auction.
I seem to have bought it, in spite of the fact that it's really unsaleable. Why did I do that? It's just such a lovely quality thing. It's a lovely thing. I'm a fool to say I didn't want it.
Oh, James, you seem a little smitten. We'll find out if he sells it on later in the show. Also coming up, Simon has a plan.
And I'd really like to buy it. So I'm going to make you a very good offer.
Oh, good.
Francis, and I'm hoping you're going to say yes, Simon.
Right.
But will his bold tactic pay off? We'll be right back.
Welcome back to Dickinson's Real Deal.
We're in Preston in Lancashire, and as the antiques and collectibles pour through the doors, it's over to Simon Schneider.
Nice little Tudorite clock, right up my street. Want to take this one home with me today. Like to pay about 150, 180 for it. Hope David doesn't come over and make me pay more.
Oh, Simon, you little sneak, you. David, I think you might be needed over here.
Now, Francis, I like this. You brought in this charming little clock.
Yes.
Now, what do you know about your charming little clock?
Well, I've had it about 25, 27 years or more, even. I think my husband had given a friend of his a couple of bottles of whiskey that he didn't drink. And he decided to give that to me.
How lovely. So, in return for a couple of bottles of whiskey, you got this lovely little clock. Well, what we've got here is it's a pewter clock. Mm-hmm. Well, the frame is pewter, but it's got a very magical name attached to it.
Of course,
it's called Tudorite, and Tudorite was manufactured by Liberty and Company. Now, around 1900, we've got what's known as the Art Nouveau movement. At the same time, we had the Arts and Crafts movement. This is very typical of that period, and Liberty were probably the forerunners, one of the most important companies making this type of material this country. It's got a nicely enamelled dial, as we can see here, with the green and the orange colours there. Mm-hmm. And we've got this lovely Art Nouveau pattern flowing all the way round. So you've got a nice sort of article here that's very saleable in today's market. And I'd really like to buy it. So I'm going to make you a very good offer, Francis, and I'm hoping you're going to say yes, Simon.
Right.
I would like to offer you 20, 40, 60, 80, 100, 20, 40, £50.
Oh, not quite. Not quite where I'd like it to be.
Not quite where, where would you like it to be?
Oh, quite a few more, yes.
Quite a few more.
Yes, we've not got a red one.
A red one? What, one of those funny £50 ones?
Yeah.
Well, I can certainly take that £50 away and I can put a £50 note there, but it's still only £150.
Yes, well, yes. Well, I meant besides that.
Besides
yes,
that?
Yes, of course.
Oh, but, £200?
Yes.
Is that what you're looking for? What I would do, because I'd really like to buy it off you today, Francis, I would put down a total of £180.
Oh, no, it'd have to be 200.
If you went to the auction, you know you'd have to pay a bit of commission if you sold it.
Yeah.
Let me try and tempt you a little bit more. £190.
Put the other 10.
Well, let's see what David thinks.
Yes.
Well, I think it's a very fashionable, desirable commercial item. We've got two estimates, 150 to 2, and then we've got what I think is the more realistic estimate, 250 to 350. So I'm going to say this 190 there.
Need a bit more.
We need a bit more. You know, we need a bit more.
We'll make it 220.
You want 220, Francis?
Please.
Yeah.
Right, £220. David, do you think I'm being fair doing that?
Well, I think it's worth a little bit more, but it was yourself that said I would accept 220, and I'm not going to interfere in that. That's what the real deal is about.
Right.
Francis, there's £220 on the table. You're quite happy to sell it for that.
Yeah.
Show me your hand and tell me what you're going to do with the money now.
Well, I've got some things in mind. I want some ornamental things for the garden.
Oh, well, that's the beauty
for
of owning...
For a start, yes.
That's the beauty of owning an antique, is that you can use the money, recycle it, and use the money for something
else. That's right, the things that I'm more interested in.
Well, thank you very much for coming in today, and thank you for bringing your lovely clock.
Good. A bit more than I expected, so I'm quite happy with it.
Very pleased to buy it. David did come over, did cost me a bit more, but at 220 I'm happy with it.
We're with Cheryl next, and it's time to get a little bit girly.
These are two really cute little items, but I keep saying to myself, stop buying these dust collecting items.
I'd like to sell, get rid of them really, and try and get my money back for them, and then go into the car boot tomorrow and have a look, maybe buy something similar.
I'm not really liking them.
Oh, Donna, can you twist Cheryl's arm?
Now tell me about your items you brought along today.
I've been an avid collector for quite a long time, and then I progressed from that and started doing like little vintage fairs and things.
Right. So where did these actually come from?
They're actually off the internet, these. Okay. About, I can't remember, I think I got this one first about 8 years ago, 10 years. I can't remember because I collect that many things. But normally get them off the car boot.
From the car boot's a bit more of a find, more, isn't it? Yeah. And exciting.
And it's, and you can kind of get history sometimes of the people who are selling them, if it's theirs or it's been passed down. And
have you got any actual history for these two pieces? You don't know who they belong to or anything?
No.
So date-wise, are these around 1950s, would you say?
I would have thought so. Probably about, I don't know, about 55, 57, I was kind of hoping, because I think that's quite a nice year, isn't it? So,
you're looking for the romance of these, aren't you?
Yeah.
I'm just going to have a quick look here.
Yeah,
so we've got like a handbag stroke. I would have thought more, is it a vanity box, maybe? We'll just open it up there. So maybe something somebody would have put on a dressing table. And almost like a sort of fake tortoiseshell effect. And this one here, I guess this is going to be sort of a little vanity pack, is it?
That's really nice.
Oh, that's nice. Comb, mirror and a compact. Very nice, value-wise. Not quite sure, really. £20.
No.
That's a firm no.
Yes. No.
So, £30.
No.
I think David's coming in for a chat.
Oh, Donna, I am but a fool. I tell you what, it's taking me back looking at you to late 50s, early 60s, which is where these come from, I think. 30 to 50, 50 to 80 is the two estimations. The 50 to 80, I think round the 80 is perhaps swinging the lead a bit. I think that's getting a bit high. I would have thought for the two, kind of 40, 50 pounds is probably on par. Can you go to auction? Can you do better looking like that? I think you can. But look across here. Now, here's a lady that could carry that. In fact, if she buys that, she'll probably go on holiday with that to Marbella, or perhaps she'll go back to Las Vegas with that on her arm. I don't know. But anyway, I think it's worth a little bit more for you, Cheryl.
Oh. Donna, I'm £30. I'm not agreeing with David. I just like it. £30, that's my bid. What would you like to do?
I'll take it to auction.
You're going to go to auction. Yeah. I think it's a good call. Yeah. Best of luck. It's been fascinating chatting to you, and thanks for bringing them along.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm not so sure that it's that much in demand, but prove me wrong.
Well, Cheryl, you've laid down the gauntlet. Let's see if the Duke can get more money for Donna at auction.
She can't make it on the day, and so I'm looking after her interests. Now, the reserve is £75. That's been set by her. Will it make it? Let's find out.
Lot 95. Novelty Stratton compact in the form of a handbag. Showing there, together with one other. Interest there at £60. Any advance on 60? 5, 70. At £70, any advance on 70?
It's just below the reserve.
£75 on the internet. At £75.
On the internet, 75. Right on the reserve.
Of interest at £75. Are we all finished at 75?
Gambler's gone down at £75. We do have a little bit of commission to take off. It's going to be close to £62 that she will receive when we send the money to her. She turned down 30, she said, no way, I'm going to gamble. And she's now got 62 quid. Donna, you were on the money, girl.
Yes, she was. Donna, you weren't a fool. Coming up.
I see no ships.
I see no profit.
But does our seller see a deal? Find out after the break. Welcome back to Dickinson's Real Deal from Preston in Lancashire. And the postie's dropped off a nice little collection for John.
We've got some stamps here, quite obviously. What can you tell me about them? Have they been with you a long time?
Oh, yeah.
Family things?
They're basically the overspill of a large collection.
Right. Were you the collector?
I've been collecting for the last 20, 25 years.
Really? Now, have you got any really valuable stamps? I'm sure
well,
you have.
Well, basically...
Penny blacks and that sort of thing?
I do have penny blacks and penny blues, penny reds. And
penny dreadfuls, they would call
all the rest of them, yeah. But the the main bulk of my collection is from Queen Elizabeth, from the coronation onwards.
Oh, right.
And I've got at least one complete set of everything that's been issued since then.
What, just for the UK, just for Great Britain?
Just for the UK.
Yeah, yes. Fascinating. Mm-hmm. I have to say, I've never collected stamps.
Yeah.
All I know is that a shade of colour can make a difference, perforations, date stamp, minefield, I think, is the word that comes to mind, as far as I'm concerned. So, I mean, your eyes are dark with the knowledge. Mine is sort of have no knowledge.
Yes.
So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a token offer.
Yes.
But I would really think these should go to auction. Let me put down my derisory offer, but I really want you to go to auction with them because they'll reach the right.
That's really where they need to go.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Well, very, very good luck to you.
Okay.
And I hope they do
Thank
well.
Thank you.
Hear, hear, John. Stamps are always a tricky one and require a specialist's eye. It's off to the sale room where the Duke's looking after Tony's interests.
Now, these items are part of a much larger collection that Tony owes, so these are just surplus to his needs. He's put them here in the auction. There is a £100 reserve on them. The question is, will they make £100? It might be a bit ambitious. Let's find out what happens.
Lot 155, collection of GB stamps, mostly mid-Victorian. Bids there at £60, any advance on 60, 5, 70, £70, any advance on 70.
They're at 70.
£70, 5, £80, 5, 90, at £90.
They're at 90.
At £90, then sell away at 90. All finished at 90, sell at 90.
Gavel's gone down at £90. It didn't make the reserve of £100. I'm afraid on the day, Tony, the real deal was £20, the cash offer that was real money. It just didn't sell in the sale room. The expectation was a little bit too high.
Joyce, hello.
Hello.
Let's navigate our way over to James to see what's landed on his table.
What have you got in here?
I have a sextant.
A sextant? You don't look much like a sailor to me.
No, I'm not a sailor, but my husband was.
Was he? When did he last use it then?
Oh, the only thing I know about it is that he owned it.
Okay. You don't know anything else at all?
No.
Well, that's how I like it.
Is it really?
Yeah. I'll tell you everything you need to know about it.
Okay, love. Love, isn't he nice?
Nah. 1943. So it's a standard issue Second World War naval sextant.
That's right.
It's all brass, made in London by Heath & Co. So this is what you use for navigating?
Yes.
You know all about
the that. The stars and the whatever.
Yeah, the horizon. Uh-huh. The horizon, the sun above the horizon tells you where you are. And you move this around, look through the telescope, line things up. Bob's your uncle.
Right.
And then you know where you are. So these are really quite common. There are lots and lots of them around.
Are there really?
Yep. And if you're interested in forming a collection, I'm your man. I've got three of these in stock.
Have you really?
Yeah. So, there's no pulling the wool over my eyes with this.
You could have pulled the wool over those baby blue eyes.
None of your old blarney.
Oh, no.
So, why are you selling your husband's sextant?
Because what good is it to me?
Maybe David will whisk you away and then you'll be able to use that to navigate to your desert island.
Mm, that would be very nice.
Shall we get some money out?
Yeah.
Here we go. £20, £40, £60, £80, £100.
Give us a bit more.
Hello, David.
Hello, David.
I see no ships.
I see no profit.
Yeah. I think by the look of that instrument, the oxidisation on it, the work that's got to be done, not a bad offer. So I'm going to say, I see the money on the table. That's better than the ships. Mm. That could be all right.
This is another 20,
no. No. I've got three of these in stock. I don't really want another one.
I bet you that one is the best.
I bet you it's not. I bet you it's not. I'm going to have to get someone to polish that for me. That's another 30 quid.
If I'd have known that, I'd have polished it myself.
Well, look, let's stop the deal now. Take it home, polish it, and then come back.
You drive a very hard bargain.
I do my best. But I think that's a good price, honestly. Do we have a deal?
We have a deal.
We've got a deal. Let's shake on it. Thanks very much for bringing it along.
Right.
You got the money you were after, Joyce, so well done you. Coming up.
That is an absolute belter. Goods for the moment. Mark is hot, hot, hot.
But what's got the Duke so steamed up? Find out after the break.
Welcome back to Dickinson's Real Deal from Preston in Lancashire.
It's the last deal of the day and Simon's jumping up and down with excitement.
I love this ivory card case. I really want to buy it. This is a very desirable wanted item. I want to pay about £400, £450 for it. Am I going to get it for that?
Wow, Simon, you're super keen. Let's find out if you can.
Eleanor, you've bought in this little ivory card case?
Yes.
Now, what can you tell me about it?
It belonged to my grandparents. They were living and working out in India. Grandpa was a tea estate manager. It's always been around, and obviously it's been handed down through the family to us.
Generation after generation?
Yes, yes.
Now, it didn't actually start off life in India, though. This particular card case started off life in the port of Canton in China.
Right.
And it is a Cantonese ivory card case.
Right.
And it's quite an interesting thing you should bring in, because we often talk on this programme about things aren't worth what they used to be.
Yes.
Well, this isn't worth what it used to be. It's worth a lot more.
Good.
This is a real flavour of the month at the moment.
Right.
Now, I think a lot of people know the Chinese are buying back a lot of their own heritage.
Yes.
Now, they made a lot of stuff for export, which was exported all over the world, that they're not particularly interested in. But one of the things they did export a lot of is this Cantonese carved ivory, and they are very, very keen to buy it back at the moment.
Okay.
And the market has just rapidly improved over the last sort of 18 months, 2 years.
Okay.
Now, I've had loads of these over the years. I've always liked them. They come in quite a few different sort of shapes and sizes. This is very beautifully carved.
Yes.
There's not an inch, a centimetre of this that hasn't been carved. And you've got all different things going on. There are always figures, there's trees, there's pagodas.
Yeah.
Now, I believe this is all done using hot pins to get this carving right. So the amount of detail in them is quite staggering, and the work that was involved was obviously incredibly hard. Now, it's nice to see that being appreciated now as much as anything else.
Yes.
It's a lovely thing and I really like it, and I would really like to part you from it.
Okay. Good.
If you sold it, what would you do with the money, just out of interest?
Mum's in a care home, so it would go
expensive.
Towards the cost of keeping her in the home.
Oh, right. Which is a very expensive
necessity. So that's where it would go, towards Mum.
Right, well, towards Mum, I would like to help you, and I would like to relieve you of your card case very much. I would like to relieve you of it this much. 100, 200, 300... I'd like to relieve you of it, £400.
I'd like some more, please.
You'd like some more, please. Like Oliver, isn't it?
Yes.
I'd like some more, please.
Yes, please.
Well,
I think it's worth more after you saying the market.
Well, the market's very strong.
Yes.
I've seen them make considerably more than that, but
they
are the ones that they really like are the thicker ones with the deeper carving. That's not to say that this isn't a very nice example, because I'm certainly not trying to run it down, but there's sort of a price guide, in my opinion, for this one would probably be 500, so I'm going to put down £500. I know somebody who's going to like this.
Just before you say what you think about it, to run across the room. I knew this was coming up and I thought, where's it go? Simon! Okay. Superb. Beautiful monogram made for a gentleman. £500 that's on the table is a very good price in consideration to the estimation.
Okay.
I've got a 3 to 4.
Okay.
Low, careful. And then there is a 4 to 6. And I'm going to say 4 to 6, realistic, but not adventurous.
Okay.
The Duke says to you, between £500 and £1,000 because I rate it. That is an absolute belter. Okay. Goods for the moment. Mark is hot, hot, hot.
Okay.
So you make your mind up, or maybe Simon might think, I'm not going to lose that. I'm in for a few more quid.
Thank you.
Well, Helena, I do love it. £550. I think that is a very strong bid, and I'd love you to sell it to me.
Would you put another 50 down because it's for my mum? Please. And then I think we'd have a deal.
There's the £50, Lena. One, two, three, four, five, £600 for the ivory card case. Thank you so much for bringing
it in.
I have to say, it's one of my favourite articles, one of the nicest things I've bought for a long time. Thank you for coming in today.
Thank you very much. I think the offer was a fabulous offer and we're really happy with it.
Well, I've got it. I know Eleanor's very pleased with the amount of money she received. I know David's very pleased with the amount of money Eleanor received. It's just me that had to part with it, but hopefully there's still a profit left in it. I love it.
Well done, Eleanor. I hope that goes some way to helping your mum. Now, all that's left to do is find out who's got the best deal of the day.
I seem to have bought it, in spite of the fact that it's really unsaleable.
Well, you've proved yourself wrong, James, as the silver dealer who you sold it to must have shared your love for the christening set. And what about that sextant?
I see no ships.
I see no profit.
You're wrong again, James. £30 wrong.
People do like hallmarks. They like to know what they're getting. So do I.
Cheryl did a little better. Hallmarks or not, the bracelet flew off the shelf at an antiques fair, earning a quick few quid.
So you've got a nice sort of article here that's very saleable in today's market, and I'd really like to buy it. So I'm going to make you a very good offer.
Simon was today's big spender and instantly passed the clock on to a collector, bagging himself a sizeable profit. As for the card case...
I have to say, it's one of my favourite articles, one of the nicest things I've bought for a long time.
Maybe Simon's keeping it for himself, as the card case is still sitting pretty in his shop. So that means Eleanor got the best deal of the day, walking away with £600 cash.
It's been a really exciting day here in the sale room. It's packed, lots of action, lots of atmosphere, bidding, buying. I like to see that. Don't forget to join me, David Dickinson, next time for Dickinson's Real Deal. See you.